And good morning, Geology? Geology?
Geology.
Geology.
This is Mini Geology here from Houston, Texas, in beautiful Montrose headquarters. Good morning to everybody. And yes, today we're going to have a student open mic for students. Today, students from the University of Houston. Good morning and welcome, students. Check your mic. Is it hot?
Yeah.
Okay, here we have Carolina. Let's see your voice, Manuel.
Hi, Daniel. How are you?
Okay, so here is the song that you decided we want to open with this song. A glass of wine in her hand. I knew she was gonna meet her connection. At her feet was a footloose man. You can't always get what you want. You can't always get what you want. Is that true? You can't always get what you want. What is that you can't get? But if you try sometimes, you might come here. Talk at the mic. You get what you need.
Well, I don't really know. I really like this song for unknown reasons, I guess. But it's like the fact that, I mean, it's interesting to think that you can always get what you want, but you're always that close to get it. It's an interesting point of view.
What is that you're trying to get now that you can't get yet?
A job.
Oh, really? So, one thing when you're in the radio, you want to talk close to the mic. Close enough so that people, they can listen to you. Good. Let's talk about it. Where do we want to start talking about? This is an open session. The mic is yours. You yell at the crowd out there. Mm-hmm. The audience is here for you. We created an audience, and they're going to listen to you, whatever you have to say. That's your mic.
Carolina, you want to start?
I want to start. Okay, so we have some ideas of what topics we're going to go today. So the first one, and maybe it will be related to getting jobs and everything that you are going in as a graduate student. So it will be like the imposter syndrome.
What is that?
So it's that feeling, like, I think in the 70s, two psychologists defined this. That is like this feeling that you don't deserve what you are getting, kind of like you always feel like you are not prepared enough. Like if you are publishing a paper, you feel like your paper is not good enough to be published, or you are always like thinking that you are not on the top, or that you are not doing things as they should be done. So we have realized that this is pretty common as a graduate student. So, yeah, that was the first topic we want to talk today.
What do you think that graduate students, they have this kind of syndrome, the imposter syndrome?
I think it's also the way as the academia life is set up. So first, I feel like it's a group of frustrations. So going from one frustration to another. So your every day is just trying to move on and continue, like, after one frustration. So it's like, maybe like getting jobs. So we were talking about getting jobs. Manuel was saying that, so if you want to get a job, or if you want to publish something, or if you are if you want to do a research project but you don't have the funding for that, so how to overcome that, so how to get money for do what you want, how to get supporters, and and how to get opportunities for the future, the opportunities that you want to get. So
Manuel, what do you think about it, the imposter syndrome? And by the way, we have another student just came in, woke up a little bit late. What's going on here, Justin?
Yes.
Julian.
Sorry about that. Yeah, I was early on a call and got a little caught up in traffic, so sorry about that. But really glad to be here this morning. Thank you very much.
So this is KPFT Radio. We are in HD3 channel. This is Mini Geology. You can write us at minigeology@gmail.com. Mike India, November India, Geology @gmail.com. And you can follow the interviews that we do in the radio and elsewhere at minigeology.com, which is a YouTube channel. So today we have an open mic. It's a session where the students, they come in and they yell at you, listeners, and their audience. And they tell you what are their problems. We started with Carolina talking about the frustrations, and we were talking about the imposter syndrome. We have here today also Manuel, and then we have Julian. And all of them, they are at University of Houston. And let's talk a little bit about yourselves. A quick peek in your activities so that the audience, they know where you come from. Do you want to start?
I can go ahead and start. So my name is Julian Chenin. I'm currently at U of H doing a bachelor's in geology. So I'll be graduating in May 2018. Really excited. Right now I'm currently working in the industry as a GIS geoscience analyst over at CAP Resources. They're a really small group in the gallery. We do lots of consulting services. And I'm also working on my senior honors thesis. In addition to that, I also work with the Energy Coalition. We're the largest energy student conglomerate group on campus. We have about 5,000 members. And our goal is sort of to unite all majors under this umbrella of energy and bring them together. So whether you be business, whether you be industrial design, economics, geology, mechanical engineering, whatever your major may be, so long as it has a tie in energy, that's what we try. We try to expose them to those opportunities, networking, professional development, internships, career fairs, etc. So that's been a large part of my time at U of H.
All right. And what about you, Manuel?
Yes. So my name is Manuel Paez, and I am a PhD student at the University of Houston. I'm in my second year of PhD. And, well, I'm from Colombia, from South America. And I came here like 2 years ago just to do my PhD here in Houston.
Carolina?
So, my name is Carolina Ramon. I am also from Colombia, but we met with Manuel here, actually. I came maybe 2 years and a half ago. I am a PhD in geology, working in sedimentology and stratigraphy. So.
How is it emigrating from your country and coming here in the United States of America to study?
It is different. We are not that different, especially here in Texas, and we have a lot of Spanish-speaking people. So, and we have like similar traditions, I think. So it's not that hard, but of course, like the way the universities work, the classes, the professors. Thinking all the time in English and trying to write scientifically in another language, yeah, that's challenging always. So.
What about you, Manuel? What are the challenges in here in a new country?
Well, I think one of the big challenges is driving a car every day, every time. If you want to go to the supermarket, do shopping, whatever, get groceries, you need a car. And it doesn't work like that in Colombia. You don't really need a car. You're always riding the public transportation. So that was a big change, at least for me.
What about the university-wise? Is it that different, the lifestyle for a student?
Yes, I will say. It is different, yes. I mean, but still, you have to study, you have to get good grades, you have to teach. Now we have to teach or be instructors for some class.
Do you see the difference in learning from the students' point of view? The students, do you think that they learn differently? Not the teachers or the professors teaching differently, the students, do you think they study differently?
Oh yeah, absolutely.
What is the difference?
I still can't tell what is the difference, but I know that there is a difference, because back when I was doing my undergrad in Colombia, we were studying all the time, and we never left our study for the last minute, for the very last minute, and they like to do that here a lot, or at least that's what I see. Maybe Julian disagree with that.
I don't know. You know, it's weird because, like yourself, I was still born in Texas, but I still grew up in a multicultural household. My mom is Syrian, and then my dad was French. And throughout most of my studies, especially in high school, I was actually started off in the French section. So going from there to the international section, and back in my high school, Audi International, it was really interesting because the French section, they taught in a very peculiar way. But immediately when you switch section, you see sort of that disparity. A lot of what, at least I've gathered from international students, is that tests weigh a lot more and you have less assignments. But whereas when you go into the American system, it seems that you have so many assignments from so many different classes that you feel completely overloaded. And at the end of the day, what time do you have left to study? At least that's a lot of my experience, because I had, you know, maybe 5 classes a day, but from those I would have 2 assignments from each class due the next day. But you also have to study for 2 exams. So really it does come down to the wire, and a lot of students do have to study last minute, which, you know, I don't like to do, but if I have coffee, I'll get through it, you know.
So Julian, we start talking about the imposter syndrome before, but the mic is yours. So you take turns, you talk, and go ahead. I'm gonna just coordinating here your thoughts, nothing else.
Yeah, I wanted to say something about the difference. Will be also like in Latin America in general, our system, you have to choose from the beginning what you want to be when you're a grown up. So you have to decide, like, I want to be a geologist since you're 17. So you start going to the university to do geology. It's not like here that you can like start doing a minor and then change minors, majors. I don't really understand all of those. But here, like, they let you have more time to decide. Like, it's like, okay, take your time, take classes, check if you like it. In our countries, it's a little bit different. Like, you have to choose from the beginning, so you are committed to something since you start. So it's a little different, and I think it has like good things and bad things at the same way. Like,
so does Colombia have placement exams? Like, you right after high school, you sort of take this college exam, and based on your score, that determines which degree you can go into. Because I know they do that in France, and like right off the bat, it's like if you get between this and this score, you can't do engineering, but you can do these majors instead.
It depends. Like, we have one that is a mandatory exam, but that is not used to place you like in a certain career. Mm-hmm. It will depend in which university do you want to study. Mm-hmm. So, for example, if you're going to a public university, as the one we did geology back there, you will take this exam and they will tell you, like, yeah, this is good for this and not for this. Like, I have heard now, when we came into geology, it wasn't that popular back then. Now it's really popular, so the you need to be like, it's similar like to a medicine career or something like that. So you need really, really good scores to get into geology right now.
Just like GREs when you have to go to grad school, right?
Yes.
So main problem is jobs. Is that what is the main concern of a student, to find a job? At least that is what Manuel told us a few minutes ago. It maybe depends on your situation.
Yeah, there are many. Like, the job is the final goal, I feel. Because it is that you're putting all this effort and all this time. So at the end, you want to have a job, like even in the academia or in the oil and gas industry or environmental, you want to be able to use what you have been working on. So, yeah, but also I feel like during the graduate experience, is included like trying to get your project, your research project, if your professor is not giving it to you. And it's pretty nice that they don't give it to you. Like, I prefer, like, having to find it for yourself. But it will take, it takes, yeah, longer. And you need to think about, like, what if we don't have the resources to do it. And we want to do 50 samples and we need money for those samples. And how to apply to grants, how to write for a grant proposal and all those stuff. So
how much of your time do you dedicate to find a job while you're studying? It is just a matter of choosing the right topic for your thesis, the right discipline that is going to project you into the market, or you do something more specific. You belong to an association, you're actively looking for jobs. What is the your daily attention to the job market?
So for me, it is like usually like during the fall, we have all this recruiting season. So this past fall, it is pretty busy, at least at the beginning, like getting your resume ready again and updating it and going to all the info sessions. Now I am part of the APG Wildcatters, that is the group at UH from the APG, the student group. So I am the treasurer of that group, so also trying to organize events and courses. And just yesterday we have the holiday party, so just being involved in all of these events and trying to get to meet people, presenting posters. So yeah, actually we do, sometimes I feel that we do too little of research actually, because we have too many other responsibilities, and the TAing is actually like super time consuming. When you start, you are like, yeah, TAing is so nice, like you have time to share what you know and like get to practice things that maybe you haven't used in a while. But then you realize that it takes a lot of your time, like doing it like every week. So
let me ask to Manuel what is his opinion on this, because he was the one putting the topic on the table.
Well, I said a job, but I didn't say what kind of job, because I am, at least in my case, I'm more interested in an academia job. So in my case, it's even harder than someone that wants to go and work for an oil company, because there are no many jobs in the academia. You have to have a strong record of publications. You need to come from a good university. So many things. You need many things to get a position in the academia. So I spent, I will say, 6 days of my week just working on my research. I don't spend really time looking for a job in an oil company or anything like that. So that's at least how I see things. I start working at 7 every day, and I go all the way up to 6 p.m. just working on my research, writing down grant proposals, working on my papers for my classes, and at the same time teaching students.
So you're kind of building up a good situation for the moment when you have to apply. So you know the bricks that you need in order to get to that
absolutely.
Position.
I mean, it's very important that you are conscious that if you want to get there, you need to start building things up. And that was the first question that my current advisor asked me when I came to his office. He was like, "So what do you want for your life in the future?" And I say, "I really want to be in the academia. I don't want to get a job in an oil company or anything like that. I'm not saying it's not going to happen. Maybe it's going to happen. Who knows? But I will. I'm going to try to get a position in the academia.
Why? Why do you want a position in the academia?
Well, the main reason is because I already work for an oil company for 4 years or 3 years, something like that. And the fact that you are doing a job for someone else and you don't own your time, I don't like that feeling. I didn't like that feeling. In academia, you basically can do whatever you want if you have the money and the time and the right people.
Yeah. Still, you have private universities that mm-hmm. are not going to be so dissimilar from an employer. That you may be looking at them from far away. It could be that they look like they're going to give you the freedom, all the freedom that you are looking for in order to develop all of your scientific questions. But then in the end, the daily life is not really like that. Just for the simple fact that they are private entities. Mm-hmm. What about you, Julian? Maybe thinking about being in self-employed? Nobody is thinking about that? Like to work for yourself? That's another way to decide what you really do.
I mean, I've always thought about it. For instance, my girlfriend, she's an entrepreneur and she started up her own companies and she is literally her self-employed boss. And I really admire that because she really has all the time in the world to do whatever she wants. She's like, if I want to work now, I'll work now. If I don't want to, I'll go have fun. And that liberty is definitely, you know, something I do strive to have. But at the same time, working for different oil companies, I really like sort of the challenge that's proposed for various projects. So, for instance, if we're looking at something in the Gulf of Mexico and they come to me and say, okay, what is this? Well, I mean, like for me, at least throughout my entire geology career, I've always liked to solve them sort of as puzzles. And every time that they give me a new puzzle, I want to solve more and more and more. So I guess, you know, being self-employed, yeah, I would love to do that. But at the same time, I really wouldn't mind working at a job that I really like because it keeps me entertained. I really like it. I really enjoy my time there. So it doesn't really feel like I'm working.
So you're not that worried right now about the job, looking for a job. Still early for you.
Yeah, it's still early, and you know, I don't think it's in that much peril. I definitely think that it will have a little spike again, and there'll be more resurgence of various geology roles open in various companies. But I think, you know, above all else, with any industry for that matter, it's really important to stay optimistic because opportunities will come. They may be a little different. You know, they may not be the traditional geologist roles that we've had in the past. It might be a little revamped. You may need some more skills to add on to that skill set.
Like which ones?
A lot of companies nowadays, they're not just looking for geologists that are the experts in stratigraphy and structural. They're also looking for people with business acumen. They're looking for people who can come into the business, do amazing technical work, but at the same time, relate it back to the commercial side. So if we're doing some kind of drilling project in some, I don't know, perhaps the Permian, they would say, okay, well, I know the entire play history here and the entire structure, but let me tell you how I can maximize it for commercial profit. So it's really adding sort of an economic geology twist to all of your projects. And that's really like the biggest key factor that they're looking at. That and also math. Lots of companies, they're going back and they're really focusing on the basics. Do you have the math? Do you have the chemistry, the physics? Those really important, you know, fundamentals that sometimes are missed by various programs. Now Calculus 3 is no longer becoming the end-all. They're looking for more people to go into, you know, partial differential equations, even complex analysis. They're really looking for some math-heavy people to come into industry.
And where do you gain all of this knowledge?
Talking to a bunch of people.
And that is because of your because of the Energy Coalition?
Yeah,
maybe.
Yeah, it's part of the Energy Coalition, but it's also I really stay active with lots of the geosociety organizations in Houston, like HGS, the Houston Geologic Society, or GSH, the Geophysical Society of Houston, AAPG, SCG, various people, and I go to their different conferences and social mixers, and I ask them, it's like, well, what are you guys looking for? What do you think is the new latest trend based on what you've seen? And lots of them in industry say, yeah, we're looking for a lot of fundamentals. We're looking for business-minded scientists and people who are really efficient. And that's sort of becoming the trend. And it's kind of, you know, a little bit alarming in a sense, because you see lots of companies, especially Total, Exxon, right now their CEOs are becoming downstream people. Downstream, they're very heavily associated with, you know, with very, very small cost margins. So they want to maximize things a lot. So naturally, as they position into those different roles, you'll see sort of that same mindset trickle down to other geoscientists and say, okay, well, yeah, I love your project, but at the same time, we have these margins, and that's something to pay attention to. So coming into industry with that business mindset helps you adapt to that and still work with it.
So, Carlian, do you want to say a word about this topic, or you want to move on?
Yeah, just maybe building up on that, like, is also, I feel like, yeah, they are just trying to be more efficient with the resources. So even, like, people resources, so they want to be human resources. They want to be able to have, like, the right people. And maybe something that is common now and that we need to be prepared every day more is managing data, so like big data and everything that is going on now. So I feel like geologists before, they were able to be supported by other people or IT people, but now the geologist is getting the role to start from learning from the data and how to use it, and also having an like math and everything, but having also like a statistical approach. So I feel that that's something that we need to continue getting stronger on, like how to use statistics, how to use, because now we are getting tons of data, but how to manage and get the best from that data will be one of the skills that I think is important right now.
What about your experience in the associations that you belong? You mentioned the AAPG and you're a treasurer.
Yes. So, experience related to, like,
is it useful for your research or your career, or is something that you do just in the spirit of helping the communities? You have hopes that that could be a channel to enter the industry, something like that?
I think is especially like trying to help the university and trying to provide a group where people can rely on, so to get this, like, to invite people and they can go to these different gathering events and talk to different people. What Julian was just saying, like, this kind of opportunities, like interacting with different people and hearing what they think about the industry right now or a certain geological problem or just the general situation of oil and gas or whatever, that is very interesting to do. So, the APG is a really nice group to be on, and it's a big community, and especially here in Houston. So we are trying to get more and more events going, and that the students have the opportunity to interact and learn more, that maybe things that we don't get to learn as, like, in regular classes, have the opportunity to practice outside.
Manuel, mm-hmm. Let's see.
Yes.
What is your, what is the beauty and what is the beast? in your daily life, you already told us that you work very hard, almost every day.
Mm-hmm.
And we're already, you're kind of giving back in this moment. Because it's already more than 7 in the morning, you should be working.
Yeah, I'm late.
But you're giving back to the community with all of your experience and your feedback and your points of view.
Well, in my particular case, I will say that the beauty of this is that I'm with my family. I'm with my wife and my daughter here in the U.S. And that's something I think has been crucial in my life, has been very important in my life, to be with them and share with them these moments, these 5 years of PhD, which are probably the most important or the more important years of my life. So as a beauty, I will say that learning things that I didn't know before is also the beauty of this. So, and then the beast.
Was it my class that you TA'd?
Yeah, you undergrads. No, it's, I mean, that's another part that is the beauty of this. You have to learn how to teach other people to transfer knowledge, and that's something that is really, really difficult, and you don't understand that, but you don't realize that until you are in front of a classroom trying to teach, and especially in our case this is not my native language, so it's even harder, but you try and sometimes you get better, you improve the way you're transferring knowledge. So I think that's another beauty. The beast, well, I will say, I mean, I would like to have $1 million to do my research. So that's the beast. Sometimes you want to do things and you want to do more analysis related to your research, but it's always a matter of time and a matter of money. So you need to find a way to get some money, and that I will say that's the only thing, the only shortcoming of coming to graduate school.
Is there anybody that helps you or teaches you how to manage your time and your money?
No, actually, managing my time was something that I learned through years. I graduated as a geologist in 2006, so I have 11 years of experience working as a geologist. So through the years, I learned how to manage my time. So that's
because sometimes students, they are exposed to a lot of disciplines, many bright professors. They talk about geology or math or even more basic things, but then you don't have anybody that is working on these aspects, that they are kind of metaphysical. Mm-hmm. So talking on the management of time, money, ethics, morals, and the philosophy that is behind the choices that that we do. So that is maybe something that I see that is not out there. So do you agree with that, or is that something that you just gain by experience, or you have like official courses that they teach these other things?
I think we don't have courses for that. I think it's something that you learn. So for me, it's also like I have previous experience working on the oil and gas industry before coming here to do my PhD. So it's just something that you learn and that you see from the people that are around you. So you...
It depends maybe on your advisor.
Yeah.
And I really want to add something. I think it depends and it changes from one person to the other. And so that's one of the reasons why I think it's so complicated to teach something like managing time. Because maybe Julian, he likes to work at night, and I can't work after 10 p.m. I don't work after 10 p.m. Because my brain doesn't work at that time. It works in the morning, a little bit, but then at night is really, really bad. I don't like to think about science. I just want to watch a movie, listen to music, drink wine, something different at home.
Julian, what about your beauty and your beast?
Honestly, the beauty is really meeting so many amazing people. I've had fantastic mentors, such as my senior honors thesis advisor, Dr. Murphy. He's been phenomenal. People that I've had in my internships, they're amazing. They've helped me grow to where I am today. And even people I've known in student organizations, they've been fantastic mentors as well. Manuel and Carolina are both fantastic TAs. I haven't had Carolina yet, but I hear amazing things. But really, that's the beauty. You meet so many different people, so many different perspectives, and you really get to learn, you know, what do you like? Do you really like geology, or do you like this specific thing in geology, and sort of discovering yourself? I definitely think the beast is the expected workload. It is a lot. It really is a lot. Even as an undergraduate, you know, you only learn the basics, but if you really want to catch up and get ahead, it's a steep learning curve. So that's definitely the beast in and of itself. However, if you overcome it, then it becomes its beauty.
I see. So you're overloaded.
A little bit.
I see. Students in general, I mean, you're exposing your point of view, but I bet that many they think like you do.
Mm-hmm. It's there are a lot of high expectations, and to meet them is definitely a challenge.
So it's not just a matter of quantity of things that you have to study, it's mm-hmm. also the quality.
Absolutely. It's huge. Your fundamentals are your end-all be-all. If you don't have the fundamentals, then there's no point in sort of expanding and seeing different things. The fundamentals are the key things, but then after that, to build onto them, it's still a steep learning curve.
What are the fundamentals for you?
I mean, your basic geology, you know, knowing your stratigraphy, knowing your structural geology, knowing your depositional systems, really the key core fundamentals for geology, and then building them up until your graduate level courses when you start looking at, you know, neotectonics or microstructural, you know, or advanced sequence stratigraphy, stuff like that. That's the only way you can build into those and really master those skills.
In the university where you're studying, University of Houston, is it specialized for specific topics, or do you see that there is a school of thought that allow you to shine for specific topics among your peers?
The University of Houston actually does a really good job with geology. They present to you the basic information. Here's the general stuff that you should know. But then after that, the professors really encourage you to find those different topics. Like, I remember in my stratigraphy class, I had Dr. Wellner. She taught us the basic depositional systems and your basic stratigraphic concepts. But then she really touched on some sequence stratigraphy, and she actually even gave us a lab to work on that. And so, you know, we learned about that. And then also when I had Dr. Robinson as my structural geology professor, he showed us the various applications you could use with it. We looked at rock deformation in various sort of areas. For instance, if you were to look at rock deformation in a large-scale formation, whereas if you were to look at it in a micro formation. So they really encourage you to explore those different options and not really keep such a narrow tunnel vision. They really want you to explore and see what you really like, and they encourage that. And go to their office. They would love to talk about it.
Okay, so you're exposed to a lot of relationships with your peers. So mm-hmm. do you really see that what you are learning makes you a different geologist from students that are maybe studying on the East Coast or the West Coast or in the North? I'm trying to understand if we have a homogeneous way to teach geology, or a very specific, geographically specific?
Oh, that's a really good question. I'm not too familiar with how the different coastal schools teach their different programs. I know that definitely U of H does have a little bit of industry touch to it, simply because we are in the energy capital of the world. But I definitely think it's really open thought, at least from the different programs I visited in Texas. They really encourage you to really find what you love. They don't necessarily want you to say, okay, you go to U of H, we're Houston, you need to think industry. Not at all. You go to U of H, you go to Houston, but you're exposed to a entire culturally diverse group. U of H is actually the fourth largest diverse university in the U.S. And that's a phenomenal experience, because you get to see all the different types of geology, not in the States, but also worldwide. Like, if you wanted to talk to a geologist from Colombia, for instance, you can get their perspectives on what they like and sort of try and tailor your school of thought towards there. And I definitely feel other schools encourage that mindset as well. They really want their students to become as exposed to as many opportunities as possible and really discover what is it that you want to do? What is it that you like? Because 10 years down the road, if you're doing stratigraphy and you hate stratigraphy, that's really going to suck.
Carolina, what about you?
My turn. Okay.
What about you? What's the beauty and the best in your daily life at the University of Houston?
So the beauty will be the power to create your own research and seeing how your ideas and your work is building up. Like maybe some days you think that even if you work 7 to 7, you didn't get much done. Like you don't see the results that you would like to see. But I feel like at the end, and when you see, like when I remember what I was doing 2 years ago, maybe when I started here. So there has been a huge change. So now I have like projects that are working on every day. I have something to do, and that will become also the beast, because it's like different from a job. Like research is your life now, so you're thinking about research and your project every day, every second, since you woke up until you are going to bed again. And yes, as Manuel said, like also a beauty will be also like having your family close, even if they are not here with you. Like my husband is here with me, so that's very, very good for your health. That's your mental health. So you having someone to take you out from just thinking in research all the time, so that's good. But having the support of your family and getting to know like wonderful scientists, so that's the beauty in this. Like I consider myself very fortunate of getting to meet people like Manuel here, Julian, and other colleagues that I have in my lab. So that is a very good opportunity.
So I'm gonna put here some music, but you can talk whenever you want about other topics.
Actually, that's a really good point I wanted to bring up. You know, Carolina and Manuel were mentioning the importance of family, and you know that is absolutely important. Really finds, you know, have a good group of friends to encourage you, because at the end of the day, if you're just pushing it and you don't like it, and it's just toxic. And it's really important to surround yourself with amazing people that encourage you to do the best, such as your family, your really close friends, your mentors, whatever it may be. And also find something like a hobby in life, something to relax. You know, you can't do geology 24/7. I mean, I would like to, but I can't. I need to have my break every now and then. So, you know, definitely find that hobby where you get to relax. You know, enjoy a glass of wine. Me personally, I love music. That's my escape. Whenever I'm stressed out or there's too much, I'm like, all right, shut down. Let's go listen to music for a bit. Really finding that hobby, you know, to relax and really enjoy life for what it is. You know, there's sometimes I take walks and that's when I have the best ideas. You know, just stick them in my notebook, work on them, mess around with them, and who knows, maybe it's the next, you know, uprising of plate tectonics. We're gonna completely defy what it is. But yeah, you know, just taking the time to relax, I think that's really important. Yeah. A lot of people miss that.
And sometimes you just need to take a walk. And exactly. It's nice to just text someone and say, like, hey, do you want to go for a coffee to Starbucks? So you just walk there and discuss something. And if you are just being like getting frustrated with something, just relax and come back, and you will have like new energy to
exactly. Continue.
You
just need to refresh your brain a little bit.
Yeah. Manuel.
What do you want me to say?
Coffee.
Well,
are you talking with a mic? The mic is yours.
I don't really know what to say at this point. No, not really.
I actually had a really cool question from at least a lot of undergrads. As they're looking towards graduate programs, what would you say is the biggest piece of advice you could give to them? Like, is it, what matters more? Is it your GRE? Is it your GPA? What are some of the different factors when you're considering grad school? What professors to consider, etc.? What's been your experience throughout?
Well, it's hard to tell. It depends on the university. Mm-hmm. But, if you really want to go to one of the big universities, you definitely should publish a paper as an undergrad. That's a must. And then get a good GRE, have some research experience, get involved like you are right now in many different associations. I think that's very important, and that's key to go for graduate school.
Carolina, what would you say?
Yeah, I will think, start doing research as early as you can. Like, I feel at University of Houston, we are such a big community, especially as an undergrad, you are many. So sometimes it's hard, to show up between all these big groups. So try to get involved, try to start talking to professors in the area that you like. So you can do research maybe for one semester in stratigraphy, and then if you don't like it, go and try something else. But try to talk with other people. If you're thinking about working with a special professor, like, start contacting that professor early and seeing what opportunities they may have. And talk with the other students, like the other graduate students. Check if you like what they are doing. And, talk to people, I think.
Yeah, absolutely, definitely. Throughout everything, whether it be industry or grad school, I feel like the social networking aspect is a really, really big important factor. So again, coming from the undergraduate perspective, how big is the jump between a bachelor's program and then into a graduate program? Because I know, as a bachelor's, you get the fundamentals. It's like, okay, here are the abstract thoughts, and then typically what I feel is the case is that when you go into your master's, and especially into your PhD, you start looking at very specific technical applications. How big is that jump? How big is that learning curve?
It's huge. That's great. The only thing I can say. It's huge. It's hard. At the beginning, you don't really know what you're doing because no one teach you how to be a researcher, so you're like figuring out, like, your advisor will help you, but it's not like a recipe that you can just follow the ingredients and do this and do that. It's more like you will figure it out by yourself, so you will start like learning how to manage your time. And that's something nice about graduate school. Like, if you don't like working at nights, you can just do it during the day, or vice versa, whatever you can manage, and you know what you have to do, and usually you don't have anyone like picking you, like, hey, you have to do this and that. And that's an issue sometimes for some people, because some people like to be like more that they know where they are going, and that people are telling them what to do in a certain way. So this is challenging because of that. You have the power to choose what to do, like, with the resources you have. So you have to be able to organize everything, like, from your time, your project, what you want to do, where are you going. So yeah, the change is huge, because here you don't have assignments, you don't have a professor that is telling you, like, go and read this. Actually, you have to be like checking for data that is being published every day, so check it if there is something new in whether you are working or something interested. So it's not, no one is actually telling you what to do, so it's a different mindset when you go into grad school. But yeah, I feel like the GRE, and yeah, you will need to get good grades, but the GRE, you can study in 2 months. Like, if you are pretty good, like, just study 2 months and you will do it. Like, if that's what you want, that is just a momentaneous thing. Like, you can do it. I think everybody could have a good GRE if they really want to do it. So, yeah, but what comes after that, that is the real challenges. So right. the GRE is just,
the GRE
you
is
will survive that.
Manuel, what would you say?
Yeah, it's absolutely different. And but it comes again to the point of defining what you want in life. So if you want to be a professor, you want a position in the academia, then maybe it's good for you to go and do a PhD. But if you just want to get a job, maybe it's better if you just go and do a master's, something like that. So you have to think about it, and it's a personal decision. In my case, I went to a master's first, and then I applied to a PhD. Mm-hmm. When I was absolutely sure that this is the way that I want to follow. So that's all I have to say.
Huh, gotcha. Yeah, lots of students now, I feel like they just need to be extremely adaptable and extremely flexible, because you're going to get thrown, you know, that thesis left and right on top of whatever, you know, comes with grad school. So sort of go on the same topic. When you're in grad school, what are some of the additional things that get thrown onto you besides the assignments, besides the, you know, clearly the research? What are some of the other big factors that come into your, that differ from a bachelor student over into a graduate student? What is sort of that workload?
Okay, so yeah, we have talked a little bit about it before, but yeah, teaching is a completely different experience, like being able to share your knowledge and preparing classes. And we have professors that help us and like guide us how to prepare, but at the end you are the one that is trying to share this knowledge with other people. So TAing is one of the biggest responsibilities I feel you have, but also like being on top of things, like checking for new publications, mm-hmm. Going to different gathering events, getting to know new people, showing your research and getting feedback, so as like doing posters or going to different talks. So yeah, you always have something going on, and if you have like grants proposals, like just being writing those, and also writing, like you have mm-hmm. to be thinking about like putting your work and sharing that with others. So writing a paper and yeah, creating figures, learning new software, and yeah, many things.
Well, it seems you are warming up, but you are also concluding this hour.
Yeah.
And thank you, Julian, Manuel, and Carolina.
Thanks, Daniel, for inviting.
Thank you,
Daniel.
Yeah. This is a mini Geology radio show, a KPFT HD3 channel from Houston, Texas. You can write us at minigeology@gmail.com. You can see this interview, you can listen to the interviews in minigeology.com. You can search the internet, minigeology, and you'll find about this project where we try to communicate geoscience to the society, build bridges in between industry, academia, society, policymakers. You know that in the previous weeks we interview people from the elite, presidents of associations like the American Association of Petroleum Geologists, president of the local association, the Houston Geological Society. We have people as high as executive vice presidents. We had the mayor of Houston here, heads of the Department of Geology, but we also have here students like today. So this is why we try to build an audience and then give an open mic with a session where the students can come and say whatever they want. So you may be shy, but you warm up like these guys they did. It took like 50 minutes to warm up, and then they finally decide to do that independently. So they're very welcome to come back here, maybe once a month. And you listeners also, you can write me again at minigeology@gmail.com. You can tell your friends from other universities to come in here. They're very welcome. They can walk in at the KPFT radio station, 419 Lovett Boulevard, 77006. 419 Lovett Boulevard, 77006. And here we go with Manuel's song, You Can Always Get What You Want. Goodbye, everybody.